With that, we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to do introductions, and I'm going to first have Dakota Cowger, our dairy farmer, tell us a little bit about himself, and we should be able to see him on screen here as he enables his webcam.
You see me now, Frank? Can you hear me?
There he is.
Yeah. All right, good. Just making sure. So, hi, my name is Dakota Cowger. I'm 24. I'm an eighth-generation dairy and grain farmer. Yes, I'm well aware that cows have kind of been a calling of mine, considering the word cow is right there in my middle, or in my last name, not my middle name. My family farms about 40 miles south of downtown Chicago in a small town called Piatone. I farm with my grandfather, uncle, and dad. We farm right on the cusp of suburbia. We've actually moved three times since emigrating from Germany in the 1860s. Our original farm was located about a mile west of the current Chicago White Sox Stadium in back of the Yards neighborhood in the south side of Chicago. In the late 1800s, we moved out to the Tinley Park Frankfurt area before relocating to where we are now in 1940. We spend a lot of time with our cows every day. We milk about 75 daily and have a lot of fun while working with them each day. I'm excited to speak to you guys after Leslie today about my farm and dairy farming in general.
Thanks, Dakota. Yep. And with that, next we'll hear from Leslie Bonsi.
Hi, everybody. I'm not giving you my age, but I am a registered dietitian, a board-certified specialist in sports dietetics, have worked in the world of dietetics and sports nutrition for a very long time, currently the sports dietitian for the Kansas City Chiefs, which is really quite exciting, and also a passion of mine is helping to dispel the misinformation that is out there and really getting consumers to get over the fear and enjoy the food they eat without the guilt attached to it. All right, so let's get started. And you know, when we talk about dairy foods being easily replaceable, so if we think about what is in dairy foods, we know that can I have the next slide, please? Okay, thank you. That there are 9 essential nutrients. And this is something that should be familiar to you all, but when people oftentimes ask questions about other foods that are non-dairy foods, are they equivalent? They're not. Because this whole idea of milk matrix, of that blend of the calcium, protein, D, niacin, vitamin A, pantothenic acid, cobalamin, riboflavin, and phosphorus are really critically important, not just for the nutritional profile, but because also of the potential impact on health. Next slide, please. So when we look specifically at the protein in dairy foods, and this is something that people sometimes get confused about, or consumers do, is we know that dairy foods are a source of high-quality, complete protein, meaning all of the essential amino acids. So in dairy, we have whey, that's 20% of the protein in milk, but we refer to that as a fast protein because it's rapid release of amino acids into the muscle. This is something I talk about a lot with my athletes. And casein is 80% of the protein in milk. It is a slower acting amino acid, which is why oftentimes the recommendation to have milk before bed to help the body get the maximum benefit of muscle protein synthesis in those long periods of time without eating. Next slide, please. So myth number 2, you should only choose low or non-fat dairy foods. As a registered dietitian, certainly that has been part of my preach over the many, many years of my career because we were told that was the right thing to do based upon the research. However, some newer studies are indicating differently. Next slide. So I already mentioned to you dairy foods matrix, and it really is that composition of everything that's within the dairy food that may have an impact on the effects of dairy fat on subsequent development of cardiovascular disease and the risk for type 2 diabetes. So when we're really looking at the whole, we need to think about, is it always worthwhile to just be recommending lower non-fat, or is there room for full-fat dairy foods as well? So let's take a deeper dive. Next slide. What about some of the studies on dairy and heart disease? And you can see here in prospective studies that were done with about 136,000 participants in many, many countries of the world and across three continents. What they showed was that dairy consumption in general was associated with a lower risk of mortality and major cardiovascular events. Okay, that's very exciting to hear that. And then a little bit more about this is that higher consumption of total dairy food, no matter what the fat content, was associated with reduced risk for total mortality and also for cardiovascular disease, mortality, et cetera. And higher consumption of only whole milk dairy foods was associated with lower total mortality and cardiovascular disease. Next slide. What about dairy and blood pressure? Well, interesting, in looking at the DASH diet and putting whole milk into the DASH diet, what they found is that whole milk dairy foods can definitely be incorporated into a healthy dietary pattern. At the end of the day, it's all about a balance in calories, but what you get improved standard biomarkers related to heart disease. So when you're looking at the difference in the diet composition, yes, the fat content is higher in high fat DASH. However, similar benefits in lowering blood pressure, reducing blood triglyceride levels, and no difference in the lipids. Excuse me. Okay, next slide. Look at what about dairy and type 2 diabetes? And interestingly, in some of the studies that have looked at this, in 17 cohort studies with about 26,000 people, total dairy intake was associated with a 7% reduced risk of type 2 diabetes per 400-gram serving. Now, that might sound like a lot, but the reality is one yogurt is 170 grams, milk is 245 grams, cheese 26 grams. So we're not talking about huge amounts of dairy to eat. But overall, benefits found with using these dairy foods. Interestingly, other prospective cohort studies using a smaller amount of dairy, 200 grams of dairy per day, also finding a 6% reduced risk of type 2 diabetes. So bottom line, we want to be encouraging dairy foods, especially at those who are at high risk of type 2 diabetes. And at the end of the day, it has to pay for the people for them to be consistent in terms of what they do and adhere to the recommendations. Next slide. So when we think about this, is if somebody said, you know, I want to think about my taste and texture, that's what I want in my dairy food. So what's the benefit of using whole milk? It can be blended with berries and vegetables for smoothies. Using in place of cream, and you're going to have these slides, but you can actually add a little bit of flour to a cup of milk and get that nice thick consistency of cream. Using whole milk because it's spicy foods for people who are not overly good with the capsaicin in the food, because that capsaicin binds to the fat globules, so our esophagus isn't on fire. When we look at 2% with skim milk, the benefit is you can lighten up your smoothie. When we're looking at people who want the taste and the texture in yogurt, using a whole milk yogurt, you can thin it with lemon juice or balsamic vinegar to make a salad dressing, things like the tzatziki or raita, adding the herbs and spices to it. It's delicious. Actually, adding a dollop of whole milk yogurt to a vegetarian stew brings the creaminess. And when we're looking at the lower fat options, marinating meat or poultry or fish, that works beautifully. It can masquerade as a mayonnaise, and then even using it as a sour cream replacement. And next slide. So when we're looking at cheese, certainly we all love full-fat cheeses, but how about pairing them with fruit for a benefit of produce and protein together, or shredding and sprinkling some of those hard cheeses on a pizza or a veggie burger? And then when we're looking at the lower fat item, we can pair a low fat cheese with a nut or with a fruit. We could make a lower fat quiche. I do that all the time and it's absolutely delicious. Or even lightening up a mac and cheese with a reduced fat cheese and cauliflower. So next slide. What do we know so far from dairy foods is that dairy foods have a neutral or beneficial association with a reduced risk for cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, and lower blood pressure in adults. And that also some of the emerging research suggesting that the fat in dairy foods may have unique properties that differentiate it from other types of saturated fat. However, even though the research is continuing, it is still critically important that we keep that total saturated fat intake at 10% of the total calories per day. Next slide. All right, so is taking a probiotic supplement superior to fermented dairy foods? Next slide, please. When we talk about fermented foods, basically a fermented food or beverage is made by extensive microbial growth. And I know sometimes people say, oh, that doesn't sound great. But the fact of the matter is we've had fermented foods around forever, and yogurt is a prime example of that. So what is the value of fermented foods? They are a source of live, active microbes. They improve the taste, the texture, and the digestibility of food, which is really important for a lot of people that have GI issues. They also increase concentrations of vitamins and the bioactives in food. They may also help to reduce some of the toxins in raw food, and they increase food safety, all critically important. Next slide. So if we're looking at this, you know, people will say, well, can't I just do a probiotic? Well, we know that probiotics, if the benefit of a probiotic is a live microorganism that when given in adequate amounts confers a health benefit. We know that yogurts are considered to be a probiotic for people that have lactose intolerance because the cultures that are in there have been well studied for their ability to help with lactose digestion. Now, however, there are fermented foods that are made with microorganisms, but they may or may not contain live active cultures at a level to confer a health benefit. It doesn't mean not eating them, it just means they're not considered to be a probiotic. But consider this, when you're eating a food that is a fermented food, particularly cheese, or yogurt, or even kefir, you're also getting the benefit of the other nutrients that are there above and beyond the probiotic itself. Next slide. So what is some of the research that's been done so far on fermented food and gut health? We know that the human digestive tract contains 100 trillion bacterial cells, or what we call our gut microbiota. And we certainly don't want to have an imbalance between the good and the bad bacteria. That's something referred to as dysbiosis. There are a lot of things that influence our gut microbiota composition, whether somebody is born through vaginal birth or C-section, if they have been breast or bottle fed, what their intake of fiber is, the use of antibiotics, level of hygiene, genetic background. And we also know that there are certain diseases that are characterized by the microbial colonization patterns that differ from healthy control. However, fermented foods may contain living cultures that can add beneficial bacteria to the digestive tract. So eating fermented foods helps to maintain that balance between the good and the bad bacteria, another reason why they're so critical. And in addition to that, next slide, please. I work in the world of people who live in pain and inflict pain a lot, hopefully. The Chiefs will do that to the Titans this weekend. We shall see. But there have been very interesting studies showing that eating yogurt is linked to reduced inflammation and improved markers of gut integrity. And this study that have looked at this, it is 1.5 servings per day of low-fat yogurt over a 9-week period of time resulted in reduced biomarkers of chronic inflammation and improve markers for gut integrity compared with the non-dairy control. So another reason for making the recommendation for fermented foods in the diet. Next slide, please. Now, we know that people will say dairy foods aren't needed for health. I hear this from my athletes a lot. So let's take a look at the next slide. The reality is that we're not doing a good job. Our daily dairy intake is in deficit. Nearly 9 in 10 Americans fall short on dairy recommendations, on average less than 2 cup equivalents of dairy foods a day. So adding just one would actually help to close that gap. And as we mentioned earlier, there's significant benefit to these dairy foods. Next slide. And this is not just me telling you that. Certainly the recommendations from the 2005, 2010, and 2015 dietary guidelines recommend 3 daily servings of dairy foods for those over the age of 3, and because there has been evidence that has linked the consumption of dairy foods with lowered risk for heart disease, type 2 diabetes, and lowered blood pressure in adults, as well as potentially helping with obesity. Next slide. Another very critical component of dairy foods is the role that dairy foods play on optimizing bone health. And we know that healthy eating patterns, including dairy, support bone health in both children and adolescents in those formative years when bone is developing. But in addition to that, the National Osteoporosis Foundation has concurred that following the dietary guidelines as well as the physical activity guidelines is an important and positive step towards ensuring healthy bone growth and or maintenance throughout the life cycle. And next slide, please. So wrapping up, what about lactose intolerance? Does that mean one has to avoid dairy? Next slide, please. Just a quick review, we're talking here about lactose intolerance. In other words, that sensitivity to milk, sugar, or lactose. And then the lactose intolerance is basically the GI response because of an inadequate ability to digest lactose. It is rare in young children. However, many individuals can enjoy milk and milk products with simple management strategies. Milk allergy, on the other hand, is a reaction to the milk protein, particularly casein. It is triggered by the immune system. It generally impacts young children, and some kids will outgrow it. And those that have milk allergy should avoid milk and milk products. So if you look at the bottom of this slide, the positive about this is that many adults and adolescents who have been diagnosed with lactose malabsorption could consume at least 12 grams of lactose in a single dose. Basically, that's a cup of milk. So let me give you some other tips on how it is that people can actually tolerate lactose. Next slide, please. All right, so how might we boost lactose tolerance? First is trying it, and that means trying a small amount at a time and potentially trying different forms of dairy foods. Sipping is another option. Stirring it, mixing it with food, and to make it a little bit more tolerable. Slicing it, so looking at cheeses that tend to be lower overall in terms of the lactose. Shredding it, so adding a little bit of cheese to another food item, and spooning it, which would be the yogurt. Bottom line is we're not starting with a milkshake the size of our head. We're starting with small amounts to build up that tolerance to it. And the good news is that a little bit of practice ultimately can translate to somebody being able to reincorporate dairy into their diet without any of those side effects on the back end. Next slide. So my bottom line, be selective, not neglectful when it comes to eating. We want to look for our evidence based on the literature, not the listserv. Hashtag spear the fear. Hashtag facts over fallacy. Hashtag score with your poor. Hashtag dairy on the plate can make your diet great. And let me turn it over to Dakota. Thank you all very much.
Hey, Dakota, are you able to hear me?
Yes, I think so. As long as everyone can hear me, then we're good, right?
Yep, okay, and now we see you, even better. Go ahead.
Perfect, yes. So earlier I was in the barn, but life on a dairy farm is constantly changing. So we had a cow who just gave birth yesterday, and the vet's here today to check on her and just make sure everything's doing good. So I'm now in the front seat of my truck. So this is a good example of how my day goes most days here on the farm. So like I said earlier, my name's Dakota Kauger. Farm just south of Chicago, like South Chicagoland. Yarn about 75 cows a day. So today I'm going to talk about our farm and dairy farming in general, just kind of things that dairy farmers are doing to make sure the cows have a good life, and in turn gives cows, when cows have a good life, when they're treated well, they give us a quality milk used for those dairy products. I'll talk a little bit, or the thing I'll probably talk about or mention is a lot of routine. Cows love routine. That's their thing. And you might be someone like that too. I'm not. I hate routine. So it's kind of always an adjustment for me when I get into a routine with the cows. But first thing I want to talk about today is cow comfort and how cow comfort equals quality milk. So when dairy farmers have their cows and they're trying to make sure that the cows are comfortable and producing milk and have as little stress as possible, there's basically these six areas of thought, and a lot of this has been studied by universities and researchers. There's these six areas that farmers focus on for cow comfort. So those six areas are water, light, air, feed, space, and rest. So pretty much probably kind of what you think you need probably in a day too. It's not too much different really. So some of these things are a little bit easier to manage and think about with cows, and other parts of this take a little bit of thought and planning and work to make sure that the cows are comfortable every day. So first thing will be water. Water access at all times. Cows drink upwards of 30 gallons a day of water. So that obviously sounds like a lot. But when they're 1,300 to 1,500 pounds, it's a little bit understandable. Plus they're producing that milk, so they're going to be drinking a lot of water every day. So then we also have light. Cows need about 6 hours of darkness a day. So that might not sound like something important maybe to you, but cows do need those 6 hours of darkness. Luckily for most dairy farmers in the lower 48 United States, it's not something really ever having to worry about because we have nighttime, right? But dairy farmers, when you get up towards into Canada, Northern Europe, when they have those long summer days, sometimes there are dairies that are farming north that have to basically have a building that can get dark for those 6 hours a day, just to make sure that the cows are getting their natural light for the day. So the next thing with cow comfort we'll talk that's important is air. So fresh, clean air. Obviously, that's something important for everyone, but with cows can, they have a really good way of bonding and getting right next to each other all the time. Whether it's cold or warm, they like being around each other. So making sure that there's proper ways to replace the air around them. For most farms, that would be the natural wind flow, adding fans into barns or whatnot. It's not something that's super, we have to think about a lot, but in farms where, so like here on the slide right now is our freestall barn. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about that with space and rest for the cow comfort six factors. But for the air here, we have, it's pretty closed when in these pictures here, but we have ability to open this stall barn up on all four sides to help get airflow through here, set up fans to make sure that that air is constantly being replaced for the cows. So then with the stall barn here, two things we'll talk about with that is space and rest. So space. So you want to make sure the cows have space so they can feed and rest comfortably. Obviously, all farms are trying to make it so the cows aren't necessarily having to lump together, or they're in really tight quarters. Like I said earlier, the cows sometimes like to do that, but it's important to give them that space and that that ability to get away from each other. The other thing about stall barn when we talked about is rest. So cows need lot of time to rest, right? Cows lie down for about 12 hours a day in five different bouts. So that means that a cow might lay around for an hour or two, and then she might get up, go take a drink, and then go sit down again and repeat that five times. So she's kind of in the same routine she always wants to be in and whatnot, but she'll want to get up and get down, not just rest for those 12 hours in one sitting, sort of say. And then cows sleep for about 6 hours a day. So when you think about cows are standing for 12 hours, sitting for 12 hours, there's only about 6 hours of that time that they're actually sleeping. With the stall barn here, so pretty much every farm has a some sort of stall barn. And then each stall barn is going to be fitted and measured to make sure that we give those cows that space and rest that we're talking about with cow comfort. So stalls are filled with sand. Sand and mattresses are typically what most farms use for cows to lay on for comfortable, so they're comfortable. So the stalls are filled with sand, and then all stalls are 4 feet wide. Most farms are going to have about that room, maybe 4, 4.5 feet. And then they're at least 9 feet long. Cows rest usually in the back 6 to 7 feet of the stall and use that front open area for their head to move or to lunge forward when they're standing up. The sand is sloped up towards the back, so her head's higher than her rear. So this stuff that might not sound very important, but it's stuff that we calculate to make sure the cows are comfortable, because when we talk about cow comfort and when we talk about cow comfort, we want to make sure the cows are as least stressed as possible, because cows are least stressed are going to produce the best milk, and they're going to produce more milk, and they're going to be better behaving. They're going to enjoy their life more. We're going to enjoy our life more. So it's important for us to make sure that we are doing all these little things to make sure the cows are comfortable. Can I get the next slide? Perfect. So quality feed is quality milk. So the last part of cow comfort is feed. So cows obviously eat a lot in a day. You know, they're 1,300 to 1,500 pound animals. So the two main feed items that they'll be that they eat is corn and hay, typically alfalfa hay. So on the left there, that's a picture of me next to silage corn, which I'll talk about in a second. And then on the right is a tractor cutting hay. So you can see the hay there on the right, and then the rows that it's cut into kind of on the left towards the center where the tractor is over. So hay is baled and chopped. So what we do is we cut hay just like in that picture, and it ends up in those rows. And then we either bale that hay into bales, just kind of what you're thinking about. Maybe you put a hay or straw bale down with your pumpkins in October or whatnot. But just kind of that thought, then the cows eat that. And then the other thing that hay is we do with it is chop it. So we take all of that hay and chop it into really fine pieces, and then we put it in the silo where it ferments, and then that anaerobic processes help break down the hay and basically put all the nutrients, pack nutrients and vitamins from that hay into a smaller area, and that helps reduce the actual amount of feed needed, so that helps us make sure we're not feeding the cows too much actual substance, but while giving them enough vitamins and nutrients. So then the other main feed would be corn. So corn, there's pretty much two main processes for it. So when you think about a field of corn, if you've ever driven through Illinois, Iowa, anywhere in the Midwest, that tall corn is typically either chopped or harvested. So the corn I'm standing next to in that picture on the left is silage corn. So I'm 6'2". That's how tall I am. And in that picture, most of the stalks are 12 to 13 feet. So that's the type of silage corn we're looking for. Regular field corn typically is a little bit shorter. But what we do is, you can see there towards my feet, there's the bare stalks at the bottom. So what we do is we come through there, cut that corn up, and chop all of it from top to bottom, leaves, the actual ear of corn, all of that. We chop that all up and do the same with the hay, small pieces into a silo. ferments, breaks down, and gets into those that more nutrients and vitamins packed into a smaller space. And then the other thing we do is take just corn kernels, so just kind of how you think about a combine going through the field, grabbing corn. We take that corn and we grind it up, mix it into like a cornmeal that gets fed to the cows. So all of this feed gets mixed together. Can I get the next slide? Make sure I know where I'm at. Yeah. So those are two pictures of hay. The one on the left is the rows of hay, and on the right there's some bales on a hay rack and whatnot. So anyway, we mix a lot of this food gets mixed together. So we feed the cows three times a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon, and once at night. And that feed all gets mixed together in a feed mixer, and we mix that hay silage, corn silage, and ground corn up with some oats, some pellets, vitamins, nutrients, and that's what the cows get to eat every day. And then they also get hay, like the bales of hay, just to kind of eat whenever. But that hay, that feed that we give them, that's what we are most centered on, most focused on, to make sure that's what best. So when we mix that together, we're sending it off to get tested to see how many, what nutrients, vitamins are in it. If we need to order and put a little bit extra calcium in there or iron, whatever it would be, we have to make sure that we're giving our cows top quality feed, right? So when it comes down to it, we're actually maybe not doing the same thing you guys are doing for humans, but it's kind of the same thing in a lot of ways. We're trying to make sure that the cows are getting their proper nutrients and vitamins in their feed and while they're eating and whatnot. So next slide. So then this slide and the next one will kind of go over the milking process. So cows get milked twice a day, once in the morning, once at night, or once in the morning, once in the afternoon, I should say. So our cows are milked twice a day. They come into the milk barn. It's kind of a scary opening the door at first. Cows love being milked. A lot of people think it's the other way around, but usually it's a stampede to try to get in the barn. So we milk a little over three groups, 21 cows in each group, and then six milkers going at a time. It takes us about 2 hours, both in the morning and at night. So first what happens is when she comes in, there's hay for her to feed on, but her udder gets washed with an iodine mix. So that's like there on the left is the iodine mix. Either it's all farms, it's either a water mix like that with rags, or you use those dippers, which in the middle picture and hanging on the bucket in the left picture, you either you can put those on and then wipe off, or you just use the mixture in the pail. And then the milker goes on for 4 to 5 minutes. And then what our workers, depending on who it is, you know, we pay attention to see what cow it is. You kind of learn when you're with them every day who's going to milk for how long, who's going to milk for shorter, longer, whatever. So then that milker gets taken off, and then she gets a post-dip of iodine. So that iodine mix that we're using both before and after is to prevent disease, and it's to prevent disease transfer among the cows. So mastitis in the udder is a huge, it's probably like the biggest disease or infection that you're going to hear most dairy farmers talk about. Even though most dairies don't deal with it that often, we don't deal with it too often, but it's something that if it does happen, you want it to stay contained, make sure she gets healthy and whatnot. So the next slide. So then the milk comes into our milk house. Milk house is that picture there on the right. The barn's like the bigger part, and the milk house is the smaller part. So the milk comes into the glass container there in the middle picture, in the middle, and then it's pumped up into that stainless steel line over to the cooler on the in the left picture. So what it goes through two filters there to make sure that there's no foreign materials in there. Obviously, that's why we're cleaning the udder before we put the milker on. But just to make sure, we want to make sure there's nothing in there. It goes through that filter, filtering twice. And then it goes into that stainless steel cooler, and it's cooled immediately to about 34 to 35, 36 degrees. Most farms don't have indoor coolers. A lot do, but I would say most of them don't, or they're kind of like ours where it's half outside. So you can see that milk house, there's that stainless steel tank there jutting out on the side. So that's the cooler. So that's where the milk is held until it's picked up. So this thing, like a lot of people ask us about how some farms have them completely outside or half outside, whatever it is. So basically these tanks have a paddle in the inside that keeps the milk from separating into fats and whatnot, but then it also helps cool it down and keep it cool. And then those stainless steel tanks are kind of like like the original Yetis or Arctic, like tumbler glasses or your hydro flask, whatever you might have. You know, that's like the double-walled stainless steel, helps keep everything, helps keep the milk cool once it's cool, or in the wintertime, keep it from actually freezing. Just kind of depends on what time of year it is. So next slide. So antibiotics. So cows get sick just like you and I. And they're treated with antibiotics when they have an infection. So just like how you and I, if we are sick, whatever it might be, strep throat or sinus infection, or that's probably the only two things I can name because that's what I've been sick with in the last 2 months. You go to see the doctor. The doctor prescribes you. You go to your local pharmacy, grab that antibiotic, and go home and take it and feel better. It's kind of the same thing for us. So a veterinarian comes out, checks the cow out, makes sure everything's doing, make sure she's actually sick with whatever, or make sure there's that infection there, kind of decides what to treat her with, and then we go from there. So obviously antibiotics in milk is the big, oh my gosh, is there antibiotics in my milk? No, there isn't. So once a cow is treated with antibiotics, she goes through the withdrawal period of that antibiotic. So every antibiotic we get has a withdrawal period. That could be anywhere from 24 to 96 hours. So if a cow has a 48-hour withdrawal period, so 2 days, and we treat her Monday a.m., we're going to keep her milk out of the line. She's still going to milk her normal times, but we're going to not put the milk up into the actual lines that we talked about into the tank. That's not going to happen. It's going to stay separate, and we're going to dispose of that outside the barn. Like, we're not going to keep that in the system. So if she's treated on Monday morning, Wednesday afternoon will be the first time she's milked back into that line, unless she's treated again. So no matter what, we're going off that withdrawal time to make sure that we're not getting antibiotic milk into the system. And then as a form of backup, so every other day our milk's picked up, depending on, some dairies are every day, some are every other. The milk is tested when it gets picked up from the farm. So when our milk hauler pulls in, he immediately opens up the tank and uses a special tool to grab a sample of the milk and put it in a container for it to be tested. And then it gets transferred into the truck, and then when that truck gets to the processing facility, it gets tested again at that facility. So if there is a quote-unquote hot load, which is kind of what milk haulers typically refer to it as, that milk does not even get into a hose at the processing facility before your milk hauler is even hooked up. The milk's tested, and then it has to go be disposed of. So antibiotics in milk, it's pretty much non-existent. It is non-existent. So there's no need to worry about those things. One more thing about antibiotics. Many cows might get sick, but not in the way that needs to be prescribed by antibiotics. They might have a nutrient deficiency that causes them to need a nutrient. So a lot of times when our cows are sick, it might just be something small where we can give them sugar or calcium or whatnot to make sure that they're fine. So that's another big thing, is a lot of times just because a vet is at a dairy farm, it doesn't exactly mean, like today, a vet's at a dairy farm, and we're going to be checking the cow who calved yesterday, her calcium levels, because we don't want her to be producing milk now and not getting enough calcium in her feed to where she doesn't have enough calcium to literally like walk around and exist. We want to make sure that she's got enough calcium in her system, and if not, we can give her that calcium supplement to make sure she's good. And then last slide. So sustainability. So a big thing with farms today is definitely sustainability and how we impact the environment. So for us, pretty much everything we do with the cows is kind of like a routine, like I said earlier. So the big thing, of course, is manure. So we live in a drainage district that doesn't allow our cow, or doesn't allow us to directly insert liquid manure into our field. So a lot of farms have lagoon type situations where the manure is disposed of, and then they come through and they insert it into the ground, and then it's used for the nutrients for corn or soybean production during that planting year. We don't get to do that just because of the drainage district we're in. We don't want to leach any nutrients directly into the soil, which could directly get into a tile or any sort of waterway underneath the ground that would end up in the local water system. So what we do is we use a lot of straw. So we harvest oats every year, which our cattle, our calves, and our cows feed. And we use that straw to bed the cows, and also mix with manure, so it's not at, so it doesn't leach and run off. So then we spread manure over fields with cover crops. So those cover crops and straw combined with both of those combined help make sure the manure doesn't run off on the surface and also leach through the soil quickly. So then we can take soil tests to make sure every year that we're not applying too much manure, which and getting too many nutrients in the soil or whatnot. So then when we go to plant corn or soybeans in those fields, we're either not applying too much or applying too little. So that helps us use what we're getting again and kind of recycle it. And then it also helps us save money from, so we don't have to spend money on nitrogen or whatnot to apply more. So yeah, that's a little bit about dairy farming. It's a lot, I know, but it's always just good to hear from someone like me. I'm a little bit of a cow fanatic. My cows, they're very good with a cell phone. They know when to pose for Snapchat. Cows are really loving, fun creatures, and for us, it's always important for us to treat them well, because treating them well equals easier time for us milking, better quality milk, more milk for us. So it's a win-win situation for everyone.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. If you can hear me again, this is Renee. I'm going to help facilitate some questions amongst our speakers here today. So bear with me. We're going to get Leslie back on her webcam. And again, just depends on who is speaking. And the first question, again, please use your chat box if you've got something to ask the group. The first question for Leslie is, there is some conflicting research highlighting the health benefits of a vegan diet versus consuming dairy/seafood. What are your thoughts on these discrepancies?
And that is an absolutely excellent question. And you know, one of the things that to me at the end of the day is I want to make sure that people are optimizing their eating nutritionally with foods that are available to them, you know, what is affordable, all that kind of stuff. It is critically important to do, right? We have to do that. And we also know that right now plant-based diets are very popular. You know, this is really not anything new. It's hello. When you look at my plate, 3/4 of the plate is plant. This is not rocket science. But it is now more what happens of people deciding what they're going to take out of their diet, and what they replace it with is not nutritionally equivalent. So that's not to discourage people from eating more plants. Of course, we want them to do that. But it is also making sure that they're getting what they need within their calorie cap, within their salary cap, et cetera. So, you know, this is one of the things that when I'm talking with patients all the time is, all right, if you're considering using a plant-based alternative, what can you actually get your needs met? None of us have unlimited amounts of food that we can eat every day. So those are the things we really need to think about. And at the end of the day, you can't be in deficit. That is not what we want to have happen. It's not good for the body to be in that kind of a situation.
Okay. I'm going to actually position this one for Leslie first. Dakota, you didn't touch on this specifically, but the question is, I often hear concerns about hormones in milk. Can you provide any additional information on this common question?
You know, I think that that's probably better served for Dakota to answer that, since he is the dairy farmer. You know, and again, I think it's one of the misinformation that is out there. Yeah, a cow is an animal. There's hormone in the milk naturally that would be there. That's not what the concern is. The concern is what people think is being added to the milk as a reason that they shouldn't have it. And a lot of this is fear-mongering is what's out there. Dakota, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is what I'm hearing from people, is an unfounded concern about what they shouldn't be worried about to begin with.
Yeah, correct. So the biggest hormone you're always hearing about is RBST, right? You go into any grocery store in this country today, this, like at any point in time, every single milk is going to say RBST free, right? It's funny to me. It's one of those things that's on the label that's like, well, RBST is legal in the United States, but for pretty much every single cooperative, like dairy co-op that milk farmers are a part of, it's illegal for you to put RBST into hormone, inject them into the cattle. It was really what I would call fad in like the 70s and maybe early 80s. And it was a hormone injected in twice or once every 2 weeks or something. But what it was found was it wasn't really improving milk quality. It wasn't improving milk production, really. It was actually giving cows mastitis more often. So pretty much every dairy farmer went away with it 30 years ago. But it's still something that's constantly brought up. You know, if you're in Canada, that hormone is illegal. So anything that's any dairy product originating in Canada, it's there's no way it's in that product. In the U.S., it really was never made illegal, just kind of because it was a thing that went out of style. No one was using it, so there wasn't really a exact need for it to be pushed to be formally illegal.
Okay, thanks, Dakota. One question for you, Dakota, because we've kind of been dialing in onto the science aspect. You know, tell us a little bit about how science-based practices, I know you mentioned university research, even into things like housing, animal care. Tell us a little bit about the science behind dairy farming today.
I would say every single thing we do on a daily basis in the farm is science-based. It kind of depends what you're looking at. So I work with my grandpa, my dad, and my uncle. So my grandpa is, he's the boomer generation, kind of stuck in his ways on many things. But one of the things that he's always been kind of like up to date with is science, for the dairy cows. It's something that most dairy farmers have kept on up with over the years. because basically your land-grant universities and your university research on dairy farming has done nothing but continually research to make things better for the cows, which in turn makes things better for us. So for us, like with dealing with calves, we feed our calves a medically put together milk replacer formula after they're a month old. That milk replacer has been studied for years on so many different trials and whatnot to make sure that it gives calves exactly the nutrients, vitamins they're needing, also gives them correct growth and whatnot. So like with the calves, there's a lot of science behind it. With the cows, it's a lot of science involved with the genetics, making sure that, I guess for me, I'm thinking about it now. It doesn't sound like science because it's stuff I do every day. But when we're looking at a cow's gestation period and everything that has to do with her calving and whatnot, there's a lot of science that goes into it and making sure that she's good from start to finish with her calving and whatnot, making sure there's the calf is in the best position possible and whatnot. And then, kind of going in with the antibiotics and whatnot. Like I was talking about, there's a lot of times that cows are sick and we don't have to use antibiotics. And the more that stuff's researched is, like there was some research done like a couple of years ago about how mastitis infection, inflammation of in the udder, and that would typically be treated by antibiotic. But there is some research that says, if you change the diet a little bit to maybe more grain versus more forage, that could help limit those, help limit that ability or that likelihood to get mastitis. So there's a lot of science that goes into it.
Okay, thanks, Dakota. Another question for Leslie. Any new research related to cancer and dairy?
Not to my knowledge. That's not to say that there isn't anything, but the majority of the studies have looked more from the standpoint of cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, as we talked about. But I would say definitely stay tuned. Definitely take a look at the NBC website because the compilation of the research is there of what we know, what is emerging, what is coming down the pike.
Okay, thanks. I think we've got time for one more. And actually, I'm going to go to both of you for this one. This one is related again to plant-based products and plant-based alternatives. The whole foods plant-based movement challenges our need for animal products, especially since cows specifically eat plants. Wouldn't it just be removing the middleman to just eat the plants instead of consuming the animal and its byproducts? So, Dakota, I think you're on screen here first. Let's get your perspective. And again, a little bit of reference to eliminating animal agriculture and cows specifically.
So I guess in a perfect world, my answer would be in a perfect world, sure, we could get rid of animal agriculture and we could just eat the plants that the cows are eating. But we don't live in a perfect world, and it's hard for me to kind of follow that logic because especially beef cattle more than dairy, they're grazing on – beef cattle graze on land that we cannot grow food on to – they're like, you think about cows that eat a lot of grass, that eat a lot of hay. That's not stuff that you and I are eating. So they're actually, they're able to take some of those plant products that's not something that we're going to eat and turn it into something that's digestible by us. I think a lot about kind of like, a cow has four stomachs. It's meant to eat forages. It's meant to eat plants, right? Do we have four stomachs to help us digest all the different type of forages that we would have to consume to keep up with a plant-based diet? From an ag perspective, we can grow corn, and all of that stuff for us to eat. But obviously, like in Illinois, we can't grow any of those, a lot of those special things that you think of when you think about a plant-based diet. How would it work for us to grow any sort of tropical fruits and things like that? How would it work for us to grow rice? Is there enough space in this world for us to be able to change work in our ecosystem to be able to produce what we can for a plant-based diet for everyone in areas where livestock are kind of taking plants that are meant for that area or can grow in that area in making it into feed that we can eat as a population.
And Leslie, very quickly, we're up against the hour here. Any additional thoughts on the protein?
Yeah, and Dakota, those are such excellent points. And, you know, the thing I would add to this is that certainly, yes, as human beings, we don't have four stomachs, and nor do we have the stomach share to be just consuming these big volumes of just fruit and vegetable every day and get nutritional needs met. That is not practical. Now, at the end of the day, people have a choice, right? They can consume animal foods or they can decide not to, but not putting that on the farmer to say, oh, you're the reason why. No, this is not the issue. Everybody has something to do in terms of taking care of the environment. Everybody also needs to think about their self-environment, their self-care, and optimizing their nutrition each and every day with what works best for them.
Okay, great summary. Thank you, Leslie. We are just a few minutes past. I'm going to wrap it up and just give you a few, again, follow-ups. There is actually a short survey in the chat function. We'd love for your feedback and tell us about the content and how we can serve the needs of the audience better. As I said at the beginning, we're going to email everyone the slide deck today. I know there was a lot of information, especially on Leslie's portion for that first half, and you'll have access to that as well. And then you'll also receive a web link as a an additional resource that has all of the Illinois Farm Families webinars that have been hosted throughout this last year or so. Those are in a format where you can watch them on YouTube and receive those continuing education credits. Just reach out to us as a follow-up on that. And then just as a quick preview, the next webinar that we have planned will be about the middle of May or so, related to May being Beef Month in Illinois. And so expect to hear from us again about an upcoming webinar in the springtime. And we'll be looking forward to everyone joining us for that as well. So with that, we'll say thank you to our panelists and our speakers. Thank you, Dakota. Thank you, Leslie. Mm-hmm. Thank you additionally to the National Dairy Council for helping sponsor Leslie's joining us today. And again, any follow-up questions, if there are things that come up or you think about something after the fact, we'd be happy to be a resource and link you up with either Leslie or Dakota or anyone else that we can help answer those questions. So thanks again for your participation, and we'll look forward to staying in touch.